Tonight, what we really want to focus on is moving you from just being fully convinced from the Word of God that all we're trying to do with this, right, is to settle two things, absolutely. That God wants every single person healed. That what Jesus Christ did at the whipping post is applicable for every single person, whether they know the Lord, whether they don't know the Lord, whether they're struggling with sin, whether they're a Satanist witch, or whatever, Jesus Christ has paid the price for them to be healed and set free. Amen? So we don't have to do background checks when we're doing ministry. Right? Are they worthy? Do they have enough faith? I wonder if they'd be open to this. So you can just freak out and just love everybody in the power of the kingdom. Amen? So this is the cool thing. And the other thing is, will God use you? And so all of this study just gets it boiled down to just that, man. It's nothing else. And so that's what this is. So now the question is, how? Okay, I'm convinced. I'm fully convinced. And what I began to realize when I started doing this training is that how many of you already believe that you are authorized to share the gospel of Jesus Christ? Okay, how many of you believe that every person needs to have the gospel? Amen? And that you're authorized to do that. Everybody needs to hear the gospel. And everybody needs to believe in Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
All right? How many of you are doing that on a regular basis? Okay? Less hands. And part of what the issues are is not just that we have to be convinced that God will do it and that He'll use us, but part of what we need is we need to hit the courage button. We need to hit the love button. And we just need to get out of the socialization that the Satan has programmed into the world system to keep us silent, to keep us afraid, to keep us second guessing. Amen? We need to just start loving people with the love of God. And so this is part of what we're going to talk about tonight. We're going to get people activated. We're not just going to talk about it. We're going to have you do some role-playing, some activation exercises, and things like that. So I hope you guys are excited about that. And this is preparing you. So, some of you here have already been actively ministering out on the streets. How many of you have been doing that? You've been ministering healing to people out on the streets. Man, that is encouraging. Praise the Lord. Isn't that cool? Some of you have said, I haven't done that yet, but I tell you what, I sure want to.
Yeah.
If God's going to heal people, I want to get in on this deal, because this is not something that's for special anointed people. It's not for super ministers. It's not for it is for regular old believers. Some of you might consider yourselves more introverts. Some of you more extroverts. And so I'm not going to train you to be like me. How's that? All right, you get to be like you, and you get to let Jesus take over your heart and your mind and flow through you in the way that He comes out of you. Each one of us is like a prism, and when the light comes through us, it comes through just perfectly with all the colors of the rainbow. Everything that's in Christ comes out from you, right? But it's going to come out from this precious lady different than it comes out from me. It comes out different from my wife and from my children. Yes, you are precious, sweetheart. it comes out different from each one of us. And so we're going to talk about just some practical ways and some of the barriers that we have to overcome, okay? I'm going to let Bob introduce himself a little bit. And we're just kind of, we don't have a plan, we have a destination. So Bob and I are going to flow together tonight. And we're just going to let Holy Spirit direct us. We do this a lot, both of us. But we're sure that by the time that an hour and a half is up, you guys are going to feel pretty confident. Like, hey, I know how to do this. And maybe I haven't done it yet, but I know how to do it now. I've got a plan. Amen?
Amen. All right. Well, I'm just grateful for the opportunity to stand up here and share with you some of what God is doing. And it's not, like Andy said, because we're somebody special. It's just because we're willing, and that's the only qualification. Are you willing?
Amen.
Are you willing to be used? And I can't even really explain why I made that choice. I think I kind of fell into it. But I was interested in healing because of some issues that I had in my own life. and I experienced God's healing throughout my life in various ways, even miraculous ways. And I long to see God use me in that arena. And so I started hanging out with people that were actually moving and healing. And I found out very quickly that I actually didn't have any kind of paradigm with which to view the healing that I saw happening. I would go on mission trips and I'd see everybody that I touched healed. I'd come back to America and I wouldn't see anybody healed. And I couldn't understand why. In fact, I didn't even know why healing happened in Africa or, you know, the Congo, Uganda, or South America, wherever I went. And I didn't know why it wasn't happening in America. So that was my introduction to JGLN, and it absolutely rocked my world because I started seeing healing happening all over the place. Now, it's part of my life. It's my lifestyle. I am an airline pilot. And I fly different things around the world. We do a lot of work for the military. Can't tell you any more than that, or I have to kill you. But then we could raise you up, couldn't we?
Yeah. So for our first demonstration.
Yeah, so what do you want to know about? I don't hide anything that I do wherever I go. So the people that I work with are well aware of just what are the things that I'm doing. And I've seen God work in some very, very simple ways, some, kind of protracted sort of things, but I know beyond the shadow of doubt that God wants to use each one of you in the same kind of ministry, because Jesus said it this way. Pray, he said, that the fields are white on the harvest. Pray that the Lord of the harvest sends laborers into the harvest. Y'all are laborers, and we're going to activate you tonight. If you never healed anybody before in your life, that's something that you need to experience. And if you don't encounter somebody that needs healing here, you're going to at least be able to practice what you've been learning. I've gotten people activated in 30 minutes that never healed anybody before in their life. They got some training in a more formal setting, and in 30 minutes, they healed somebody in some pretty amazing ways. So y'all had more than that kind of training already. You have the foundation. So now this is just a practical kind of thing. And I'm just really grateful to be part of this.
Amen. All right, so let me just tell you what I do to train people, because I'm not going to be able to take every one of you out in my group tomorrow. I mean, can you imagine going up to somebody in Walmart and you got, it looks like Verizon commercial, You got one person, you got 100 people walking behind them, like, I noticed you're king, and they're like, oh my gosh. But you ought to actually think that way. When you step into somebody's life, you got the entire kingdom of God backing you up.
Amen.
Amen? So it's the network. All right. So this is what I do. Let me tell you about my buddy Curtis. He's a school teacher, and so last summer he said, Andy, I'm really excited about what I'm hearing about God doing in your ministry. I got the summer off. Would you be willing to take part of the day to just take me out and be with me and help me get going in this stuff? Because I believe in healing, but I'm just not seeing it. Anybody feel what Curtis is feeling? It's like, I believe it, and I'm a little frustrated because I believe it. Frustration is kind of a good thing. It's the front end that's forcing you to change, right? It's something on the inside growing up inside of you. I've got a vision that's bigger than what I'm walking right now. And God's calling you into that destiny, so it's a cool thing. So I said, Curtis, come on over. We'll have lunch together, and then we'll go out and do some training. And so we finished up lunch, and I said, sweetie, give me a Walmart list. And so she gave me a Walmart list, had 10 things in it. So I said, come on. You know why I do that? Because I want you to see, this is not just an outreach, this is a lifestyle. Right? So how many of you guys go shopping? Go shopping for groceries? You go shopping at Walmart or Dick's Sporting Goods, or you run out to the mall? Do you realize that I haven't gone shopping in like a few years? I don't go shopping anymore. I go make disciples, and I pick up some groceries while I'm out. Do you see the difference? Because you hit that go button, and that's the thing that activates all the promises. Do you understand? Go make disciples. Boom, you hit that go button. Now I'm on mission with Jesus. Everywhere I go, when I wake up in the morning, when I step out my door, I'm hitting the go button and I'm going, and He is with me even to the end of the age. So that's something we got to slow ourselves down, because this culture is programming you to be a consumer when you're shopping. It's programming you to be an employee when you're at work. It's programming you to be a boss or a supervisor or this or that. But the kingdom of God has to override all of that socialization. You are an ambassador of Jesus Christ wherever you are at.
Amen.
Do you understand that you first and foremost represent the kingdom of heaven? You represent Jesus. And God has authorized you to speak for Him, to act for Him, and He backs you up wherever you go. So we started off, we pulled into the parking lot, and it's always the same. You know, the whole way there, my flesh is like, I wonder if anything's going to happen. You know, I wonder if I'm just wasting this guy's time. You know, I mean, you got the carnal mind, it's still kind of going off. And the whole time I'm like, thank you, Jesus, that you're with us. You know, you hear the whispers in the background. So you just, it's not about not hearing those thoughts. It's not about not feeling certain things or feeling a little, you know, it's about not submitting to it. It's about staying in agreement with who Jesus is in you. And so we went to Walmart. And we're going in, and this lady comes through the front door, and she's got one of those little wrist braces. And I said, "Are you going bowling?" You know, and she said, "Oh no, I have carpal tunnel." And I said, "I knew that. I was just kidding with you, sweetie. Let me see that real quick." And she put her you know, and I said, "Let me see that real quick." And I put my hand out like this, and she had no idea. She's like, it was like automatic, you know. It was like, she had no idea what I was going to do. Do you understand? So sometimes just let me see, hey, can I see that real quick? And just put your hand out. Right?
Boom.
Boom. And then it put it in there, and it said, right now, in the name of Jesus, carpal tunnel, you get out of this girl right now. Be healed. I said, sweetie, move that around. Jesus loves you so much. And she's moving it. She goes, wow, that feels better. Thank you. And she kind of kept walking. Right? So what did I do? I kept walking too. You know what? You can do Holy Ghost drive-bys. Alright? And there's not really a formula about how to interact, because people are so different, circumstances are so different. You interact with people to the point that it's giving grace to them, it's giving life to them. And so if you feel like, wow, they got that wrist healed and now they're ready to move on, you don't get that little, you know, this is not a string attached with every act of kindness and love that you do. The string is to heaven, it's not to you. Right? It's to Jesus, it's not to you. So go ahead and let her take off. Maybe she's in a hurry. She doesn't need you. Now all of a sudden say, hey, but you got healed. Let me talk to you about Jesus. You know, maybe that's why she's walking on. Maybe she's had people shoving stuff at her all the time. Okay? And it's not that we hold the name of Jesus back. Absolutely not. But we represent Jesus. We encounter them with Jesus. And so we go in there, and some of the conversations are, hey, how you doing? You know, and I said, all I'm doing is being as loving and as kind, as an encouraging, as an engaging of a person as I can be.
Right.
I'm just looking for people that I can encourage, that I can bless. And there's sometimes that you see an opportunity that goes a little bit further than that. That you see somebody that you could talk to. You actually have a conversation. So I saw one guy. I got red shoes on today. This was later on in our day. And I saw him, and we had actually changed places now, because we had seen enough miracles in Walmart. I wanted to go somewhere else, change the setting, right? So that we see this isn't a Walmart anointing. You know, it's not that the principalities over Walmart have been utterly defeated, and you know, you go three blocks down and now you're under a new region and a new regime. Man, we got some cockamamie ideas out there, guys. So anyway, so there's this guy, he's walking towards us with red shoes. And sometimes it almost feels like a word of knowledge about a way that you could strike up a conversation with somebody.
Yeah.
And so he's walking towards us, and I said, hey man, those are some awesome shoes. And he goes, oh, thanks. And then I said, where did you get them? How much did they cost? that's cool. And then, so we're building a little bit of a rapport. And then I said, hey, this might sound like a crazy question, but do you happen to have anything in your body that gives you aches or pains or any trouble at all? And he said, man, it's funny that you should ask. I was just coming from that pain clinic, and they were telling me that this pain's going to stay here unless I get a surgery. And I said, man, that is so cool, because we've been out praying for people today, and we've seen miracles already. Y'all, and by this time, my friend had been involved. And so I'm doing the hard part as a disciple maker. I'm teaching him how to engage people and stuff. And then I said, you ought to let my friend pray for you, because God uses him for miracles. Right? And my friend goes, okay. You know? And so, sure enough, my friend just puts his hand on the guy's back and says, right now, in Jesus' name, back be healed, all pain go. It's that simple. You just say what you want to happen. You have authority. You tell the bad stuff to go. You tell the body to be repaired, to function properly. You don't talk to God and say, oh God, please come and do that. If you talk to God, you just say, thank you, Father, for what you've done for them. Thank you for your love. What? Because Jesus said, when you pray, believe that you've already received what you've asked for, right? Yeah. So we've already received the kingdom. We've already received the benefits of the stripes on Jesus' back. But when it comes to mountains that need to move, you speak to them. You tell them what you want them to do. Get out of here and get in the sea. Amen? And you do that in faith. But our faith is in God. And this guy got completely healed. He was able to touch his toes. And then he's freaking out. You could tell. He's wanting to talk but doesn't know what to say. See, there's grace still there. And so I said, listen, man, we're so glad that Jesus healed you. If you know we didn't do that, it's because God loves you. I don't know what you've ever heard, but he's not ashamed of you. He loves you, and he wants you to know that what he did in your body, he can do in your entire life, your entire heart. Do you know Jesus? You know what the guy said? He said, actually, my aunt's a preacher, and she's been telling me about this. And I said, man, I think she's been praying for you. He goes, I know she has. And I said, man, and he said, I know I need to get my life right with God. I said, man, let's get that settled right now. And so we took that interaction further, because there was more grace. It wasn't me pulling him into something. He was pulling it out of me, and I was able to give that and carry that further. Do you understand? There's times where people get healed and they don't want to talk to you even after they got healed. I remember one lady, this was that trip. She was stocking cans on a shelf at Walmart, and I walked up to her and said hello, and I just make eye contact with people and be kind. And sometimes people are not used to being treated like human beings on the job, you know? And so I said, hello, how are you doing today? And she goes, can I help you? I mean, she didn't know, like, you must want something from me, you know? And it just came out of me, you know? It's not like a formula. I just said, no, but I think I can help you. And she goes, okay. And I said, yeah, you're doing a real physical job picking stuff up and down. Listen, do you happen to have anything that gives you aches or pains, any problems at all like that? You know, and I'm just, at this point, she has no idea why I'm asking that. She might think I'm a doctor. She might think I'm selling part of some multi-level marketing campaign, you know. I don't know what she thinks. But at this point, all she feels my kindness. She feels my concern, you know. And she says, well, actually, how many of you guys know that sometimes when people are hurting, they just love to talk about their problems? They feel isolated about it. I mean, if you open that door of kindness and sincere concern, sometimes people will start telling you, and they start going right into their history, their medical history, their bills and stuff like that. Now listen, in a healing ministry, we cut that off, right? Because we explain to them, we tell them, listen, we don't want you telling us all about your problems, you know, because we explain that. We've got some teaching foundation. But out on the streets, it's an act of the kingdom to give people your time and attention and to be a good listener and to show them that you care, right? And there's a place where they'll eventually take a breath, right? Oh, you hope. And then you say, man, I am so glad that I asked you. Right? I asked you about this, and I'm so glad because they've got something going on. I said, how would, she said, I need a knee replacement. And I said, that's so cool because I give knee replacements. And she said, you gotta be kidding me. I said, yeah, but I do mine for free. She's like, get out of here. I was like, yeah. I said, in fact, I can do it right here, right now. She's like, oh, are you serious? I said, yes. I said, it won't even hurt. You don't even have to lift your pants leg. And she's like, you gotta be kidding me. How do you do that? I said, it's easier for me to show you. Just give me your hand for a second. And you know, I put my hand out here just like that, and automatically she's going, yeah, she had no idea. You know, you just practice it. You know, give me your hand for a second. And he's like, yeah, it just happens. She put her hand in mine and said, right now, in the name of Jesus, knee be new, all pain, go, go now. In Jesus' name, function properly. And I said, check that out, sweetie. And she goes, oh my gosh. Oh my God. Oh my gosh. And I said, is it all better? She goes, not all better, but that's like crazy better. And I said, well, sometimes I don't do it right. I'm actually out here with my friend. God really uses him for miracles. You know, this was the earlier time, and this was the first time. And I said, you ought to let him pray for it. And he goes, okay. You know, he's like, yeah, you know, I know what I'm supposed to do now. And so we went out and he put his hand on her, knee. Hey, can I touch your knee? He asked her permission. You know, you don't ever, as a guy, you got to be careful, the guy-girl thing especially. And usually, you don't even have to touch their knee, but he asked, and that's a good thing to do if you feel like you're going to want to reach there. And you say, hey, can I touch your knee? By this time, you know, she had enough grace in her to go like, whatever, you know, just get this thing done. This is freaky already, you know. I don't mind a little bit more freakiness. So he put his hand on her knee and said, right now in Jesus' name, knee be completely healed. And sure enough, man, she's doing like this and she's squatting up and down. And she's like, oh my gosh, it's completely, you know. But she's like doing a Cotton Eye Joe in the middle of aisle four, you know. And she's stomping on it and then she goes, and then it happened. She went, I don't even believe all this. And then she looked right at us and goes, thank you. And then kind of turned away. You could see the wall just went up. Right? So what did we do? That's all the grace there is for that interaction from us at that time. She says, whatever it is, now I don't want you preaching at me and telling me I'm going to go to hell. Right? You could tell something had gotten in there before. So what did I do? I said, ma'am, I am so glad that Jesus gave you a new knee. He loves you so much. You be blessed today. And we walked away and left her with a brand new knee in the name of Jesus and the space to process this with Holy Spirit. Amen? Do you understand? So that's part of what we do. Now, do they all look like that? Sometimes you're saying, hey, how's it going? And people walk by you and give you that kind of stranger danger, like, do I know you? You know? Right? Sometimes you say, hey, I noticed your cane, or you seem to be limping. Do you have anything that gives you pain? Right? So you just talk to people about what you observe if you observe something. Sometimes God will give you this impression. He'll give you a word of knowledge. But hey, I'm always like, go for the word of knowledge for dummies, right? So if God doesn't give you anything by the Spirit, just say, hey, I got a crazy question for you. Do you have anything that gives you aches or pains, any problems at all in your body? It's a simple question, isn't it? And that gives them the freedom to either ask or answer. Sometimes they'll say, man, why are you asking? I love to help people and see them get set free from their pain. I see it all the time. Right? So at this point, I'm not necessarily telling them about Jesus. Because I'm a Spirit-filled, charismatic, Holy Ghost evangelist, and you need to be healed and set free. You know, I don't go all religious on them. Do you understand? You don't have to play act. Just be yourself. And it's not about manipulating people. Some of this is what I'm sharing with you, is that it actually helps you navigate the landmines that the enemy has placed in there, in some people, in some cultures, so that you can steer around those in love and minister to people. So we'll get a little bit more specific, and then we'll start doing some activities. I want to give Bob an opportunity. I'm sure you have some ways that you that you engage with people.
I think that the question that Andy's talking about is there's a lot of different ways to express it, but the easiest way to remember is really the one question that anybody can ask: do you have any pain in your body?
Yeah.
What you said was, do you have anything that gives you any discomfort or
aches or pains or problems?
So if you can't remember that, just remember: do you have any pain? Are you feeling any pain right now? As people, we as Christians, as believers, we know that we're supposed to make disciples, and the first step to becoming a disciple is to get born again. And so we have this in our minds, and we know we're supposed to, like, go out and witness and do all this stuff. But I want to set you free, just like Andy has done. I want to set you free from this necessity to bring everybody to a decision. At every single person you meet, any person who is willing to stand still long enough for you to talk to them, you know, your job is not to get them to pray the sinner's prayer. In fact, there's no scripture that says you have to ask Jesus into your heart, okay? Your job is to bring them closer to a decision. And with God's grace, you may have opportunity to actually bring them to that place of decision. Sometimes people are just waiting for somebody to ask. They're just waiting for someone to ask them, are you born again? Do you know God? You know, just any kind of simple thing like that that invites them to make a decision. Sometimes they're just waiting to ask. And so always looking for opportunities to ask. But if you think that your job is solely to get them to pray of the sinner's prayer, then you're really wasting your time. Don't go out to the mall, because you're going to wind up being frustrated, because you probably won't see that many people that actually are willing to sit still long enough. Sometimes, like Andy says, it's just a drive-by. You have an opportunity to lay hands on them. I'm always looking for those kind of opportunities, even when I'm not like going to shopping or whatever. I sat on an airplane yesterday next to a guy, and he saw me putting some stuff in my iPad, and I showed him, yeah, here I was preaching in Pakistan. And he said, what are you going to Bismarck for? And I told him what I was doing, and the next thing I was doing is I was asking him that question: do you have any pain in your body? He said, well, yeah, actually my knees hurt. So I prayed for him. Actually, I didn't touch him. I just pointed at his knees and commanded the pain to leave. And then he's sitting down. Fortunately, he didn't have a seatbelt on, but he's sitting down, and I said, well, try it out, see if you have any pain. So he's like going like this in his seat, and the pain was gone.
Amen.
Same thing today, going in the supermarket. This lady saw this t-shirt I had on. She asked me some questions. I didn't really approach her. She approached me. And I asked her, do you have something that you need to be healed? And she said, yeah, I'm feeling really dizzy. So I commanded over her dizziness. She was serving me. And then same thing, she cut it off because she had work to do. She had to go. You can do this in a restaurant. You can do it just walking down the street. When I was in Antigua in the Caribbean, I went to the front desk of the hotel. Hey, I have a hobby. I like to get people healed. Can you tell me where I can find some sick people? And she said, well, you can go down to the public market, and there's a lot of drunks and drug addicts down there. They all need healing. So I went down to the public market, and I bought a couple of big like boxes of French fries, and went where all the drunks and drug addicts were hanging out. And I got an opportunity to minister to some backslidden preachers that were drunks and drug addicts. Mm-hmm. So that was pretty cool. I always say there's some simple steps that you need to follow when you want to minister healing to somebody. It's not a formula, because you can point to it, you can speak to it, you can just put your hand on somebody, you can command it loudly, you can command it softly. You know, there's just all kinds of different ways. You can use prayer cloths, business cards that you've prayed over, mm-hmm. So many different ways that you can minister healing. The bottom line is, if you can remember just a few steps. Number one, you speak to the condition and you tell it what to do, what you want it to do. You want it to go. You want it to get out. So you tell it that. Number two, I like to include why to tell it why it has to go, because of what Jesus did. There's a lot of different scriptures that you can use there. If you have the presence of mind to remember something like that, if you don't, that's okay. Number three, then you tell the body what you want it to do. So if you want their body to be healed, you just tell the body to be healed. If you want it to receive strength or life, you command life. And then number four, ask them to test it. If you don't have an opportunity to test it, one time I told this gal, actually, I was looking for her. She was limping, and I asked her if I could pray for her. And she said, I have to go to a meeting. This is in a hotel. So about 20 minutes later, she came out of the meeting, and I saw her. She was leaving with a friend. I actually thought she worked for the hotel staff. So I said, come on over here. I'll get you healed. And she said, no. So I ran after her. I actually went after her. Come on. Just give me a chance. I said, give me 3 minutes. I'll get you healed. Actually, it didn't even take 3 minutes. It took 60 seconds. Mm-hmm. And her friend that was with her was telling her, you have a problem. Let him pray for you. And so I didn't touch her. I just commanded the pain to leave. And she was testing it already. I didn't have to tell her to test it. And then when she said it's gone, just like you were recounting with your experience in Walmart, she said it's gone. Her friend looks at me, how did you do that?
Yeah.
Just kind of incredulous. How did you do that? And my only response, because I knew I had just a few minutes to get my message across, I said it's the love of Jesus.
Yeah.
He loves you so much that he sent me after you so you could have an experience of his love, the manifestation of his love.
Amen.
If you can't remember anything else, remember, do you have pain? And when the healing is manifest, then that was the love of Jesus.
Yeah. Amen. That's good. Good. Well, we're gonna have some time to do some activities here in just a second, because one of the things that I've noticed, this is probably a decent analogy. About 4 months ago, my family and I I record my ministry sessions, and this was back in maybe middle March, and I was looking at. I just uploaded, I put a video on my laptop and was starting to do some editing, and I realized, oh my gosh, man, look at that. That gut is over the winters, it's gotten huge, and I'm becoming one of them, And so we bought a P90X workout series, and so we've been going at it hard, and I just realized, that I've been doing this now for 4 months, and so I've got like most of these workout routines completely memorized. And there's a whole science behind it. I'll tell you, I could watch those videos over and over. I could memorize all those workout routines. I can even tell you the science behind all of these workout routines. But if I don't get my butt off the couch and actually do, then I'm not growing. And part of what we've been conditioned to in the church is a deception, and it's this, that unless you're doers of the word, you're deceived. It's a deception. And here's the deception, is that we mistake agreeing with good biblical theology with faith. Faith is not what you agree with. Faith is what you live by. The just will live by faith. Amen? But part of what God intends as a grace in the body is not that each person hear the word and individually have to figure everything out between just the spoken word and the actual doing. What we actually need is we need discipleship. Amen? We need people who will take us out and show us how it's done and get us under their wings and say, see, it's not so hard. Look at, man, Andy just prayed for somebody, and it wasn't like they went flopping on the floor and just getting up with gold dust shooting out of their ears or something like that. You know, it was like, you know, it looked like they still had a little bit of pain. It wasn't 100% healing, and they were ready to move on. But Andy, you know, he's like, hey, let's go find the next one. Thank you, God, for what you're still doing in their body. Amen.
Amen.
Right? So you just keep moving and you keep going forward. So I want to move towards those activities. But before we do that, what questions do you have? Let's take a little bit of time for question and answer about what are some of the things, like if you think about going out and having these kind of interactions and beginning to get started, what are some of the questions that you have? Biblical questions, save those for Curry. Practical questions, let's do it. Yes, ma'am.
I wanted to get some advice on how to handle family.
Okay.
So I'm one in the family that believes that Christ is sick. And when I have someone in my family that's sick, like my daughter, I go to pray for her, and I do exactly what you're saying. Okay. I command the pain to go or whatever. And she goes, this doesn't work, and she'll walk off.
Okay.
Or my husband will say, when I pray for something, he'll go, just go take some ibuprofen, you know.
Right.
And I get real frustrated because I don't see it happening there, but I've seen it elsewhere.
Okay. All right. So she was saying, I need some advice for my family because she's the only one who believes. And as soon as she starts to try to minister, she kind of gets this little, you know, rebuff. The daughter walks away. The husband isn't cooperative and those kind of things. So I would say, you don't change. You don't let darkness in others become darkness in you. And so you keep shining the light, because it's not about it's not about what they believe or don't believe. Sometimes there's that issue of, are they anti? Are they even willing to receive some ministry? So sometimes we're interested mainly in healing, but sometimes we need to bring in the whole kingdom, right? And so they're not just a project to get them healed. One of the things that we've been handicapped with in the church is that we're supposed to be equipped so that each one of us can do the works of ministry. But what we've been socialized into is being good attenders, and then being good inviters, right? And then we get equipped in healing, and now like, okay, I can attend, I can invite, and I can heal. But Jesus wants us fully equipped to do the whole kingdom work. And so sometimes what they need some ministry of the word. Hey, I just want you to know. Look, I know you haven't seen healing break forth in your body when I've prayed for you. But I just want to let you know that Jesus loves you. Whether you get to see it yet, it's there. And that's why I'm not stopping. And they might say, well, whatever. You know, and they say, yeah, it's going to be awesome when you start seeing this. And don't worry, because I'm still growing, right? So look, you just let them know. Be honest with them. Let them know it's about the love of God. It's about the love I have for you. It's about the truth. And you just keep going. And if they say, hey, mommy, would you just stop? Would you just leave me alone? You say, you know, it's just so hard because I love you so much. But sometimes you got to back off a little bit. Family can be a little bit of a challenge. There's other people that have had testimonies. Kevin, you want to share? Come on up here, please.
Let me just say one thing.
Yeah.
Because your daughter walks away, that doesn't mean you have to stop. It doesn't stop when they walk away. I've had a lot of people healed by text, by instant message, right? I've never even met them. Will you pray for me because they saw something or whatever? Okay, you hang out there. I'm going to be commanding over here. And I'm commanding. I don't say anything to them. The next thing that they hear from me is, how is it? Mm-hmm. Check the pain. Wow, you know, it's less or it's gone or whatever. You can command whether your daughter is there or not, mm-hmm. right? And just consider your motivation is to get her healed, not to be vindicated by her getting healed in front of in front of you.
Yeah.
So if she gets healed, she's going to know you're praying for her. And that's going to build favor. After a while, she's going to have an opportunity, or she's going to have a situation where she's going, I can't handle this. I need my mom to pray for me. Mm-hmm. And then she's going to come to you, and you have an opportunity like that. It's just don't limit yourself by the fact that you can't lay hands on them or they are rejecting you, because light overcomes darkness. You have authority. You don't have to ask permission, her permission, to kick the devil's butt out of her body.
Good.
period.
It's mostly my husband I get frustrated with.
Yeah, same thing. Humility is the absolute key there.
And on that front, in my family, you were my wife, I was your husband. She was in this, she was seeing it, she was doing it, and she was telling me about it and sharing it. And I was like, that's your thing, this is mine. But she prayed for me, she shared what was going on, she would have phone conversations and tell other people what she was seeing when I was near. So if you push someone, lots of times they'll lean back, they'll push back. So if you're pushing too hard and they're backing away, then you might want to just pull back and pray, and really pray, say, hey, Holy Spirit, just really work on them. I want this to see them. I want the blinders to come off. And just really focus your prayer, and like they were saying, you are the light, you continue to be the light. But if they're backing away, then just shine the light, but show them how you're helping everyone else.
Yeah.
And they will get convicted.
Yeah. Yeah, just keep bearing fruit. Just keep bearing fruit. It's okay, yeah. And some of it is letting go. We have this, like, we have a lot of college students. We have, like, a college group that comes over. And one of the things that they have to deal with is their parents and their friends thinking that they're weird. And so one of the things you got to let go of is you don't go this direction because you want to be popular. You know, one of the things that we've had gotten used to is, you know, if you're a Christian, you know, that makes you a good person. That makes you, you know, people, that raises your esteem in people's eyes. And we fall in love with that. And if you're only willing to live out your Christianity as far as it builds you up in other people's eyes, you're not going to go very far. The whole discipleship walk starts with deny yourself, take up your cross. Amen? Follow me. And so then that's part of where in the prayer closet, it's laying down how they make you feel. It's not about your feelings. It's really not. It's about Jesus Christ, because we want miracles not so that they'll feel better about us and so that they'll see that we're right. That's not, and so we got to lay that down. We want miracles for Jesus and for them. It's totally not about us. And that's what sets you free to approach a stranger, because now you're not worried about what they think of you. You know, the Word of God says there's no law against love. Amen? Galatians, you know, against such things there is no law. So you can just love people as much as you want. So why don't you just go ahead and say, I freak people out with how much I love them. Amen? I just am not afraid to love people. Isn't that true?
I'm getting scared.
Yeah, this is good. Yeah.
When you talk about like going out to Walmart, is that also something you wouldn't talk about going out with other people? What, are you willing to go out and do that by yourself as well?
Yeah, I do that by myself. I don't do it just when I'm with other people. This is a lifestyle. It's something that I do. It's something that I am. I see a need. And one of the things that I would encourage you, okay? This is something that helped me. Sometimes when you first start off in this, you see somebody walking with a cane, right? And I remember I first went through the DHT and I saw somebody with a cane, and I was like, whoa. You know, and he was a slow mover too, you know, it wasn't like, okay, God, he was going way too fast, he's busy, you know, he probably wouldn't nonstop, you know, it wasn't like that. You know, I mean, we can talk ourselves out of so much sometimes, and sometimes it's just like, hey, you know what? I see a need and I move towards it. You just go, you train yourself to be on spiritual autopilot. That I'm not evaluating. I'm not worried about what they think of me. If I hesitate at all, it's simply, Lord, show me the best way to actually start this engagement. Right? That's all I'm doing. It's not whether I'm going to or not. So one of the things that I would encourage you to do is to begin to, in your prayer closet, in your time with God, to begin to declare over these situations and tell yourself and tell your God how you are going to respond. So let's just do that, okay? Why don't you stand up for a second? And I just want you guys, if you can, just to repeat after me, okay? I am born again. Jesus Christ is Lord. He is Lord of me. He's Lord in me. And He is Lord through me. His heart is in my heart. I am an ambassador for Jesus Christ. I have a mission.
I have a message.
And heaven backs me up.
I'm authorized
to freak people out. I'm authorized
to destroy the works of the devil.
God knows my heart.
He knows who I am.
So I am not worried about what other people think of me.
If they misunderstand my heart,
that's okay.
I am not worried about that.
I walk in freedom.
I'm a spiritual man.
And no man judges my value.
My value has been determined once for all.
I am worth the blood of Jesus to God.
But not only I,
but every person that I see.
And His heart burns in me.
So I see canes
and crutches
and arms in slings
and oxygen tanks
and shopper doodle carts,
and I move towards them.
I'm not worried about that.
I don't wonder if something's going to happen.
It already happened 2,000 years ago.
The Son of God set them free.
And silver and gold I do not have,
but what I have,
I give.
I have the kingdom.
I have the kingdom.
I have healing.
I don't have to ask for it.
I've already got it.
I'm a spiritual UPS man.
And Daddy has bought them an awesome package.
They're going to be so excited to receive it.
So I walk up to them.
And I engage them with love and kindness.
I introduce myself.
And I ask them about their condition.
And then I minister to them.
And I lay hands on the sick.
And they recover.
I have faith in God.
When I speak to mountains,
they will move.
Because it will be done for me.
Because heaven backs me up.
So I speak to that condition.
And I say, in Jesus' name,
devil, you and all your works,
you must go.
You must go now.
I set people free.
And I lose healing.
And people are healed.
In the name of Jesus.
I am not afraid.
I walk in victory.
Because God knows who I am.
The devil knows who I am.
And I know who I am.
I don't live for other people's opinions of me.
Because I'm free.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Does that sound good?
How many of y'all pray like that?
That needs to become your prayer life.
Needs to become stepping into the presence of God and speaking to God about what God says about you.
And that's one of these ways you can train yourself.
You know, this isn't on the playing field yet. This is in your prayer closet.
This is when you're getting up early in the morning.
This is the early morning workouts at the gym.
This is before you hit the field.
But this is the stuff that when you train yourself, you're aligning your thoughts.
You're aligning your emotions with heaven.
Amen?
That's that twisting of a cap
so that now everything that heaven's put inside of you, when it goes like this, it just pours out.
Amen?
There's nothing inside of you blocking that. Right?
So this is important.
All right, so we're going to get into some activation exercises, and part of this is going to involve you guys, okay? So what I'd like you to do is I'd like you to move around the room. I'd like you to find somebody that you don't know and find a partner. Go ahead and do that. Now, everybody knows that Jesus is tall, and so the one that's tallest gets to be Jesus first. Me and Bob's going to be partners. I love Bob. All right, this is what we're going to do real quick. All right, so in this instance, I'm going to minister to Bob first, and I'm going to show you how we're going to do. So the first thing I want you to do is we're going to go to them, and we're going to do a little bit of a role play, okay? All right, so what I want you to do is practice introducing yourself to a stranger. I want you to treat them like they're a stranger. This is somebody you don't know, right? And just introduce yourself, just like you would stop somebody in the mall, somebody that you want to speak to, or somebody that you know you're going through your day, and just say, "Hi, how are you doing? My name is..."
Jesus.
Are you? Yeah, there you go. Smarty. Here we go. All right. You know, I'm really not that religious. Here we go. All right. Now, so you just say, "Hi, my name's Andy. How's it going? I noticed..." And then you just make up something. Just say, "Hey, I noticed you were limping," or "I noticed you had this." And just ask them about something. Just get used to introducing yourself and making a quick transition into asking somebody about a condition. All right? Got it? Can you do that? Can you practice that? Because it's one thing to see some, "Oh, I could do that," but man, I'll tell you what, you get out there and you start fumbling, like, "What do I say?" Man, it's funny. There's one guy that I've been demonstrating this with for some time, and we were out at coffee together, and he got really distracted in the middle of our conversation, and I could tell he wasn't there anymore, and then I noticed there was an old guy walking by with a walker. You know, you kind of get this Holy Ghost peripheral vision, like, squirrel. You know, you're like totally, you know, you just see it. You know, you're totally distracted. But you train yourself to move towards that. And he's like, "Oh, I'm in a conversation." I said, "You want to help him, don't you?" He goes, "Yeah." I said, "Go for it." He goes, "I'm not sure what I'm going to say." I said, "How about you start off with, 'Hey, my name's Wade. And I noticed you're walking with a walker. Do you have pain or do you use it for balance? What's going on? Just curious." Right? "Hey, my name's..." "How you doing?" You know, "Or I noticed this." Isn't it funny how we hesitate? And he said, "You know, it's funny. I got up. I did it. I just said, 'Hey, my name's Wade.'" And then everything, you know, it's just crushing through that stranger danger barrier. But you got to train yourself to say, "I'm not afraid. I have a lot to offer people." Amen? And I'm not worried about whether they accept me or not, because I'm so accepted by heaven. I'm not going to them emotionally needy. "Oh, please accept me. Oh, please." You know, it's not about that. Or, "I'm really afraid." Like, we're not afraid of people. Christ in you is not afraid of anybody. He loves them so much.
Yeah.
They're worth the risk. Amen?
That's right.
Amen. All right, so just practice that, would you? Let's do that. This is the thing, honestly. It's like just some of the basic stuff. It's crazy. All right. Do the same thing. Switch it up. Take two. Shorter one's Jesus. Same thing. Switch it up. The partner that was the injured party, now I want you to switch up, okay? I want you to go introduce yourself to them. Same thing. We're just going that far. Just practice introducing. "Hi, how are you doing?" Yeah. Stop real quick. That shouldn't be too hard. Okay. Let's stop right here. Let's stop right here, if we can. That wasn't too hard, was it? Okay. That wasn't too... Whoa, we just lost... No, I didn't turn it off. I didn't turn it off. No, it's still green. All right, so you got to listen to me. Something happened here. Hello, hello. Something back here. I don't know what it is. All right, anyway. All right, so this is what we're going to do. The tall one's Jesus again. This time I want you to introduce yourself. I want you to ask them about their condition. And this time, if you have a condition, anything at all that needs healing in your body, I want you to just be honest with them. Say, actually, I do. I want you to ask them, do you have anything that gives you aches or pains, any trouble at all, anything like that? Keep it real simple. And then I want you to tell them, don't tell them all about your medical history. Just a second. Don't tell them all about your medical history. If you've had 15 surgeries on your back and you've got more metal rods in your back than there are, in automobiles, don't tell them that. Just tell them, I got back pain, right? Because we've seen more metal taken out of people when the person who's praying has no idea there's even metal in there. It's amazing how as soon as we hear something, our mind fixes on it, and Holy Spirit was like, oh man, now their brain is in the way. You know? So just tell them, yeah, I've got several conditions. I've got this and that. Just tell them what needs to be healed. All right? And then we're going to do something real simple. I want you to say, I want you to go ahead and follow through. I want you to say, well, right now that's going to go. I want you to get used to speaking in faith, to just declare, Holy Spirit's not hesitant. Holy Spirit isn't wondering if He can do it. Isn't that cool? Right now, God's going to heal you. Let me see your hand real quick. Okay? And then just say, just declare over it. Tell the bad stuff to go and tell the body to be healed. What did you say? Tell the bad.
Why it has to go.
Tell it why it has to go, right?
Tell the body what you want it to do.
Right. Bad stuff out. Sickness go. Pain go. Because Jesus is Lord. Now, body be healed and function properly. And then what do? You have them test it. Now move that around. Test it out. See if there's something you can do. And tell me what's changed. Test it. Tell me what's changed. Right? Okay. Can you do that?
Yep.
All right.
If it's something that they can't test or whatever, get them to make some motion that gets them involved, because that activates their faith.
That's right.
Right? And it can activate the healing.
Don't ask them. Tell them. Say, hey, do something. Move that around. Can you get up? You know? All right. Ready? Let's do this. And then we're going to... Once you've done it, just put your hand up, okay? Yeah, right from the beginning. Yeah. People got healed. You got one, two, three, four. Nine. That's, isn't that cool? We're just pretending up here, guys. That's good. All right. Now, how many of you ministered to somebody and they got healed, and this is the first time that you've actually seen a miracle happen through you? One. Hey, isn't that cool? Isn't that cool? You guys thought you were coming here just so Kurt could pray for you. And it's like, woo, baby, it's Jesus! It's Jesus! Amen? I'm sorry, I'm excited when people discover this stuff. This is good. I watched way too much worldwide wrestling when I was a junior high. I'm sorry, I just get this way. All right, now, what happens if you minister to somebody and you say, hey, check it out, and they're like, well, it's still there. Okay, let me tell you this. If you pray short, you shouldn't take more than 10, 15 seconds if you're praying over somebody. Really quick. In the name of Jesus, right now, all pain, you leave their body. In the name of Jesus. Excuse me. Good. And then be healed. Test that out. So you're telling them something really, really quick, and if they test it out, it says, well, it's still there. Usually I just keep the momentum going. If they, unless they're acting like, you know what? Thank you. You know, if they're acting like they just need to get rid of you, hey, that's okay. You released the kingdom. All you're doing now is what Curry called, it's the working of miracles. You're working with them a little bit so that their healing manifests instantly. It's not about whether they're going to be healed or not. You're not telling them, hey, do something and hoping that it might happen. This is like when you crack those little pixie, those little glow-in-the-dark sticks that, you know, you're having them do something so it activates all of the stuff so that they can see that they're healed.
Right.
And so if something didn't happen instantly, sometimes they'll say it's still there, but it actually decreased. So if it's pain, sometimes at the beginning it's good to say, so is there anything that you can't do now? If you move that, you know, you can ask them a little bit. I don't want to make this too complicated, but on a scale of 10, you know, 10 being like you're giving birth and 0 like you don't have any pain at all, you know, what number would you give this? You know, and sometimes they say, oh man, it's like an 11. I'm like, oh my gosh, let's get that baby out of you. And so right now in Jesus' name, all pain, you leave them. Go, go. Go now. It's a now thing, right? We're not hoping that eventually one day that, because this pain, Jesus already bore it in his body. Amen? It's already been removed. He already carried it. So this isn't like you're trying to get God to do something. He's already done it. You're releasing what God's already done. Okay? Now, and so if what happens if they say it's still there? Then you say, then this is all I usually do, is I'll say, well, sometimes it takes more than once. Hold still. Boom. And just hit it again. In Jesus' name, pain, go. Right now. Go. Try it again. Right? And then they'll say, you know, a lot of times, you know, that second one, they'll start noticing some change right away.
Right.
Okay? Second, third time. So, how many of you didn't see a complete healing? You still have some stuff going on in your body. All right. This is what I want you to do. I want you, if you're ministering to them, I want you to minister again. Just do the same thing. You don't go, well, let's see. Last, you know, sometimes you start spitting on the second one. You know, the first time was like, in the name of Jesus, pain, go. You know, now it's like, you know, in the name of Jesus, go! You know, it's like, you don't got to try harder. All right? You know? We played nice last time, but this time, evil hand, you know? You don't have to do it. Don't change your strategy. It's all because of the stripes of Jesus, right? To say, hey, let me hit that again. I want to see you completely healed. I know God's already at work at you. And sometimes you gotta work with people, right? They're not just a project. They're not a healing project. So you gotta look at them. And sometimes it's like, hey, I just want this. This is real. And I know God loves you. This is going to happen. Don't you worry, because Jesus is Lord and He loves you so much. So sometimes you speak these words of life into them. Okay? There's not like a formula, but for the most part, if you pray short, you have them test it and say, okay, let me hit it again. Sometimes it takes more than once.
There is one other option that he didn't mention. What if you're commanding and it gets worse?
Mm-hmm.
That's something to consider. You don't drop your groceries and run. But you have to know something that's happening. What's happening is that the devil is responding to your commands. So if there's movement, you should be encouraged. Even if it gets worse. Sometimes it gets worse right before it pops and leaves.
Yeah, I remember this time where I met this young man on college campus, and he said, I always have pain in my legs, but it goes all around in my body. So I was like, you know, man, whenever you have pain that kind of moves around, yeah, it's probably a spirit. So I said, hey, does it hurt right now? He says, yeah, it always hurts in my legs. So I started to reach my hands out towards his legs, and he goes, ow, dude, that hurts. And I wasn't even touching him. You know, so whatever was in him was gripping harder to try as a last-ditch effort to make him think that I was hurting him. And so I just said, in Jesus' name, everything causing him pain, you go from him now, right? And so, listen, sometimes the enemy, if you have that happen, it's almost always a spirit of infirmity. And so you say, right now, you go, right? Just be aggressive, and it'll leave him. All right, so the same person that ministered, If I want you to go ahead, just minister again. Hit it again. We're going to hit it a second time. I want you to get used to that. So, all right. So sometimes what happens is that at the beginning they might say, hey, nothing seems to have changed, but you hit it again and then you see the truth. You're actually making an impact. You are releasing the kingdom, amen? And things are changing. And so, hey, look, maybe, you know, like if you think that 10 is all that needs to take for the miracle to break forth right then, listen, you're planting the seed in them. Every seed is the kingdom, and it grows up to be a full thing, okay? But what you're doing is you're just pouring more and more in. So, like, if you get 5, maybe they didn't feel anything. You released the kingdom, and only this much life went into them. And so you hit it a second time, boom, the whole thing's there, right? So you're releasing life, okay? So it's now filled in all the holes, so that's good. All right, so we're going to do the same thing. We're going to switch so that now the short one is Jesus. And I want you to do this. Yeah, the short one's Jesus. And I want you to start right from the very beginning. I want you to walk up to them. I want you to introduce yourself like you're stopping them in a public place and say, hey, hey, it looked like maybe you have some pain. I was just curious, right? And then ask them about their condition. And then sincerely, if you have something, please tell them. And then go ahead and minister to them, right? Just like you would out in a public place. I want you to get used to being awesome. You're just going to have to get used to it. This is the new normal, all right? You ready? Let's go.
One thing, before you begin, hang on a second. One thing you need to know, these are Jesus' own words. Every time you come in faith, all you have to have is the size of a mustard seed, right? That's what he's saying. Something is happening every single time. Something's happening. So don't buy that nothing happened. You're doing something. You're putting life in. Something always is happening.
Amen. Right,
go.
Amen. Amen. And let's
as a body of Christ, let's be a safe place for one another to take those steps. So when we learn something, even if it's theological, hey, you learned who you are in Christ. Okay, great. Now we're going to break up and have conversations. And one of you is going to start off like this and say, hey, you know, I've just noticed that you have peace and joy, and I've been a Christian for 20 years, and I just feel all discouraged. How can you use what we just learned tonight to set them free, right? So it's always, you got to equip the saints to do the work of ministry. And it takes us not just hearing and not just agreeing, but actually becoming doers of the word. Amen? This is exciting. All right, so let me tell you, you're going to have Bob introduce a fourth scenario, but I'm just going to fix with three. When you minister to somebody, the first thing I would encourage you to do is that make up your mind from the beginning that you're going to have them test. Okay, unless it's just like, man, you can tell while they're ministering, they're just ready to go, okay? But so, like, you're going to minister to them, and you're going to say, hey, is there something you can do, you know, to test that out? Do something you couldn't do, right? Why do you do that? Because Jesus, if you look at the Gospels, the way that He healed the most was by telling somebody to do something that was impossible or made no sense for them to do it. But, you know, stretch out your hand. Go show yourself to the priest. Rise, take up your mat and walk. Amen? So He healed just by issuing the command. And that when they acted under His authority, guess what happened? He was speaking in the authority of the kingdom. Guess what happened? As they acted under that authority, guess what got released in them? Kingdom. Boom. All right? And so you're going to have, their healing is going to manifest. It's going to manifest in one of three ways. One is going to be the instant boom miracle. It's just all gone. They're freaking out. Oh my gosh, this is crazy. How do you do that? Practice that. Right? Practice speaking spontaneously. Father, I thank You that people get healed and they get freaked out, and I get to tell them, and You talk to God. Talk to Him. Get used to speaking spontaneously about the awesomeness of Jesus and how much He loves people and how much they're worth to Him and what He can do in their whole life. Hey, and you know, you practice that with God, and you practice that in your life teams. Hey, let me tell you what God thinks of you. You know, you pray for your friends. Hey, let me tell you, you know, there's times where you're going to see people get healed instantly. It's not even just, it's amazing, all right? And that when you lay hands on somebody, that's what you're believing for. It's already a finished work, right? Yeah. So why not just release the whole package? So believe God for the whole package. I don't care if it looks like a big one. It only looks that way. That's all that is it looks big to you, but there is a devil that got his tail whooped 2,000 years ago who's hoping you don't realize that it's a bluff.
Amen.
Okay? All right, so and the other thing that can happen is that it can manifest progressively. They know, well, it is a little better, but not completely better. No, not completely better. Well, hey, let's get this all the way out of you, right? So when they're seeing some progress, that's really cool. So usually, and then sometimes it's like, oh, no, I'm fine. So, you know, and so like with Bob, you know, I usually don't say, hey, give me 3 minutes, I'll get you healed. Because like, you know, I don't know, Madison, 3 minutes is like, 3 minutes? Who are you? You know, they're like, hey, give me 30 seconds. What do you got to lose except your pain? Right? You know, it's like, hey, man, I know this is free. You know, sometimes you tell people, say, I got a crazy question for you. I know this is a little crazy, but you got to believe me. I've seen so many people. And sometimes you can tell them a little testimony real quick, you know. Hey, I just prayed for a guy the other day. His hip was completely paralyzed and in terrible agony. He couldn't move. And then all of a sudden, you know, he got healed just instantly. He's walking. He couldn't understand. And he didn't even believe this stuff. So look, I'm not trying to like change what you believe. You don't have to believe anything or nothing. It's just so awesome. I want you to have this, right? And sometimes they're like, no, thanks. And then they're like, all right, well, hey, I just want you to be blessed. Listen, my daughter Noelle had this, you know, she's the quiet one at the check-in table. You know, she's the 15-year-old. There's my wife, who's just awesome. She's outgoing. And then there's the young one. She's outgoing. And then there's the 15-year-old. And she's awesome, too, but she's a little bit more quiet. Well, there was a time where we were out and about, and she saw this lady sitting on a bench,
And so that's one thing to look for. Look for people that are sitting down. Right? A lot of times people who have pain in their bodies are sitting down. Why? Because they don't like walking around. So when you go out to the malls, when you go out to the parks, when you go out and about, keep your eyes open for people on benches, right? My daughter went up to this lady, and she was sitting on a bench, and she had a metal cane propped next to her. And she walked up to her and said, "Hi, how are you, ma'am?" She goes, "Oh, I'm fine." She said, "Oh, you know what? I noticed your cane. Do you have pain in your body?" She goes, "Oh, honey, when you get my age, you'll have pain too." My little daughter said, "No, I won't, but..." She said, "But I would like to help you with yours." And she said, "Really?" She said, "Yeah, I pray for people and God heals them." She goes, "Sweetheart, I don't believe in God." She goes, "That's okay. It'll still work." And then she said, no, sweetheart, no. No, thank you. Please just leave me alone." She goes, "Oh, okay. Well, you have a great day. I just wanted you to be well and be blessed." And she walked off. You know, and I knew this because by that point in our family, my kids used to be really good at finding people for me to pray for. We had crossed that threshold. Now it's like, you see him, you do it. Yeah. You know, and so it's like, "But Daddy wants you to know." So she tapped me and I want to watch her. So I just kept my distance and it was great. I thought, hey, you know, knuckle bump, great. Because, you know, it's not about the results and everything working out exactly how you would want. They're not just a healing project. This is a person. She moved into her life with faith and with love. Amen? She took the interaction as far as there was an opening. Water flows into the opening. There was no opening at that time. So the water just flowed out, you know? And so I'm like, "Man, that's awesome. You're just carrying the rivers of life. This is cool. It's my daughter. Let's go find somebody else." You know? So we went on, and about 20 minutes later, we're walking by, and we just totally weren't thinking of it. And we're walking by that same area, and all of a sudden I hear Noelle. She'd be a great Asian wife for some reason. She walks like five paces behind me all the time. I don't know what the deal is. Anyway, I hear her go, "Sorry, I didn't mean to..." Yeah. Sorry. Anyway, so she says, "Daddy," and I turned around, and that lady had come over and said, "Hey, sweetheart, I just want to apologize to you. I had no cause to be so rude to you. It took you an awful lot of courage, and you just wanted to bless me. And, you know, I really don't believe, but, you know, there's no harm in... I need all the positive energy I can get. So if you want to pray for me, you can." And she goes like... And Noel's like, "Oh, great." He's like, "My dad's going to pray for you too." You know, so I walked over there. And so we just, you know, I said, "Noel, you speak, and I'm going to hold your hand, and I'm just going to agree." And so Noel said, "Well, in Jesus' name, be healed. All pain go from her." And so she said, "Oh, thank you, sweetheart." She was thinking this is still a spiritual Hallmark card, you know, like this is sweet, you know. And I said, "Okay, go ahead, move around." And sir, and the lady went like this, and her jaw dropped. You know, I was like, "Ma'am, I just want to let you know, I don't know what you've experienced in church, but I just want to let you know it was the religious people that killed Jesus. And he is madly in love with you. He hung on a cross because he loved you that much. And what he just did in your body, he wants you to know, no matter how you feel about him, you've been deceived. And he wants you to know he's really real and he really loves you." And she goes, she just started crying and gave me a big hug. And that all started with what was a refusal. Yeah. All right? You know, when you just go and move into people's life in the power of the kingdom, you don't have to be something else. My daughter's a very quiet young lady. Right? Some of you have no problem striking up conversations with strangers. You can talk to people all day long, right? So you can talk in conversation, that's okay. But here's what you can do is you can begin to, you know, sometimes there's no easy way to transition that conversation. You know? You sneeze. "Oh, God bless me." "Oh, speaking of God," you know, there's just like no way to do that. You know? So what I've learned, a real simple thing, is you can just say, hey, you know, it's been really nice meeting you. I've got a crazy question for you. Do you have anything that gives you pain, any trouble at all in your body? You know, and you know it's a little bit crazy. You're going out the cultural boundary. So that's why I tell them, hey, I got a little bit of a crazy question for you, right? Because there's people that are crazy and that don't know it, and those are the ones that people are afraid of. And so if you just say, hey, you know, that kind of, hey, this is a little bit crazy. That's one way that you can just transition that gap and let them talk. And then they might ask you why. Just say, this is crazy. You might just tell them, say, you may not believe this, but listen, I pray for people and God heals them instantly. And I just know that so many people are carrying pain or sickness around in their bodies, and it doesn't matter what they believe, it just always works because of what I believe, you know, or whatever, because of what God does in me. You know, or you just tell them, you know, courage telling everybody, you don't have to have a special gift, but sometimes that's for in the church, right? I just tell them, I have a special gift to heal people. It's the Holy Spirit. You know, like I don't tell them that, but I'll tell them that later. And you can have this too, right? This is for everybody. His name is Holy Spirit. So part of what you're going to have the instant miracles, you're going to have the progressive things. So what happens if you've prayed for 2, 3, 4, 5, 6? You know, how long can you pray for people?
As long as they'll tolerate it.
Yeah, it has to do with them, doesn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. Totally up to them. I did have another. I had another scenario. If this has more impact, if you're a guy, but here's something you can do. I've done this. It's unusual, especially in today's culture in America. But stand up in a restaurant, get everybody's attention. Hey, everybody! I just want to let you know, I'm in love with a man, and his name is Jesus Christ. There's a guy that I know that in a year won 2,500 souls to Jesus in Denny's doing just that.
That sounds like real a lot of fun. I'm going to have to try that one. I'm going to have Bob with me when I do it, though.
Somebody,
excuse me, everybody. Can I have your attention? This guy told me to do this.
He wants to be on my team.
Yeah. All right. So let me talk about. What happens if they don't get all the way healed immediately, or if you minister to somebody and they say, "Hey, man, you know it's still there," you know. Or, yeah, sorry, third. I wish I could tell you that it was gone, but you know, it's still there, you know? What do you do then? You know? Because at that point, there's a point at which you can tell you believe a lot more in healing than they do. And they're like, you know, okay, the fifth time, you know, sorry, it's still there, you know? Do you start getting discouraged? No. You don't pull your faith back. You're releasing the kingdom into them, right? Amen?
Yeah.
Right. And so, look, you don't need the healing to manifest right then to affirm your faith. You don't need it to affirm the fact that God works through you. You don't need it to affirm God's love or value for you. You have the Word of God for that. Amen? You've got the cross of Jesus Christ for that. You don't need that miracle for you. You want it for them and for King Jesus. Amen? Because Jesus suffered for them to have that miracle right then. All right? Now, so what do? Sometimes, you know, let me tell you a story. I was in Zanzibar last year. And, you know, how many of you know you got to raise a lot of money to go on a mission trip and things like that? And you got all these people praying for you. And you're going over there and you're going to actually make a contribution. You're going to train leaders how to make supernatural disciples outside of the church. You know, and so it's all starting. And so our missionary family had messed up their schedule and they weren't there. So they basically said, go shopping for 2 days and get used to, you know, jet lag and that kind of stuff. And we'll be there. You know, I'm like, okay, this is great. And so we just went out, and I started to realize nobody's spoken in English there. There's nobody, you know, nobody knew hardly anything. And so we're walking down one alley, and, you know, usually it was like, hello, and they would say, hello, and then I'd say, how are you? And they'd go, you know, that was it. You know, they used up their one English phrase they could remember from grade school. But this guy, he goes, hello, and I said, oh, hi, how are you? He goes, I'm doing just fine. And I was like, oh, cool. So we started a conversation with this guy. And we talked for maybe 5-10 minutes. I got to know about him, his family, his what he does for a living, that kind of stuff. I said, hey, it's been nice meeting you. We're going to walk down here. But before we do, just a crazy question. Do you have anything that gives you any aches or pains or any physical problems in your body? And he says, oh, it's funny you should ask. I'm very concerned. I'm completely deaf in this ear. And I said, really? He goes, yeah. 8 weeks ago, I just woke up and I could not hear. I had no earache. And so I'm very afraid of this one going deaf too, because it had no warning signs. It's just like completely deaf. And I said, oh my goodness. Well, I'm so glad you asked. Just put your hand up here. And he put his hand up there. And I put my hand on his and I said, I'm going to pray for you. I said, right now in Jesus' name, ear you open, deaf spirit, go now.
Yeah.
Ear open, right? And I snapped and I said, test it. And he goes, sorry, no, nothing. I said, let's do it again in Jesus' name, right? Three times in Jesus' name, ear open, right? I didn't change my strategy. This Jesus gets it done. And after the third time, people in the alley started kind of, he started noticing he was being noticed, you know, because I stand out in Zanzibar, I'm a different color, and this is a Muslim country, you know, 98%. And so I could tell he's getting a little antsy. So I said, hey, man, I so appreciate you. You're an awesome person, and I'm believing God for complete healing for your ear. Right? And then I walked away. Now, as I'm walking away, you kind of hear these thoughts start to go off, right? These feelings that try to get in there, but it's the stranger's voice, or it's the old man talking. You know, you can imagine, you know, spending all this money and having this nice missionary newsletter to send to all of the people that were praying for you and supporting you. You know, you have these flashes like Curry's, like, you know, you're going to bury another one. You know, I'm like, you're going to end up, you know, nothing happened for 3 weeks. You know, and I was like, but I knew that wasn't the truth, right? I knew not to agree with it. You can't sometimes stop those feelings from starting to come or the mindsets. You just don't agree with those emotions. You don't agree with those thoughts. And so you know what I did is I've learned this, is that you just start thanking God and you get a little bit louder than a stranger's voice. And I just thank you, God, for the privilege of representing heaven and laying hands on that man. And I thank you, God, for healing his ear 2,000 years ago. And I thank you for the privilege of being part of this miracle in his life. And I thank you that you're faithful to perform your word. You watch over it. Thank you, God. And I just walked on and we had a great rest of the day. 2 days later, and I forgot all about it. I honestly did. You don't have to babysit Holy Spirit. Did you do it yet? You know, it's not like trying to get a teenager to take out garbage, you know? Holy Spirit is faithful. And my son's faithful. I love him. He's a good guy. He takes out the garbage without being asked. It's great. Anyway, so here's the deal. 2 days later, my son and I were walking down this alley, and I hear behind us, Mr. Andrew! And I turned around, and it was that guy. And he goes, my ear! And I said, yeah? He said, the next morning I woke up perfectly hearing again. And I was like, and he said, and I thought of you! And I was like, that's cool, I've been thinking of you. And I walked over to him, we had a nice brief conversation, and I told him about Jesus, and it was great. And so, listen, that you need to be that bedrock aligned. That you say, you know what, I'm believing God for miracles, and I'm looking for instantaneous manifestations. That's why we do the working of miracles, right? We work with people so that the pixie stick gets activated and that miracle starts glowing forth. But If we don't see it instantly, we don't let our heart sink back into, oh, this didn't happen and God never uses me and what's wrong with me? Why doesn't it work? Maybe I need to go Google something else and go to, you don't have to learn something more. You just let all those doubts that surface and all of those feelings that surface come up to the surface, right? And then you just slush them aside and agree with what the Word of God says about you and what the Word of God says about what He's going to do. And then you just get stronger and stronger and stronger. And then you're going to start seeing this stuff. And sometimes you go into seasons for whatever reason. You don't see a whole lot. But the neat thing about it is you weren't doing it because you were seeing it. You were doing it because God told you to. Amen. Right? And then you find out later that whole season you weren't seeing stuff. You start finding people that 3 months later come and tell you, oh yeah, I was healed the next day. Or oh yeah, my dad got out of the hospital the next morning. Or oh yeah, I've not had a problem since. And it's like, what? This whole time the devil's been telling me, God never uses you for nothing. There's something wrong. You know what I mean? So I just got to let you know that that can be normal.
We had just a couple of weeks ago in Pakistan, a woman 7 months pregnant, the baby had died. She was carrying a dead baby and in labor and a lot of pain. So at first, we're just always taking an opportunity to get someone else activated. I had somebody that had attended the DHT that I taught over there. And once I realized that the child was dead, then I jumped in to impart life. But the pain never went down. This lady never, the pain level stayed rock solid. I only had a certain amount of time to minister to her, but I just commanded life, life, life. And 5 minutes later, I was gone. And I, whatever kind of thoughts you have, after maybe something like that, or any time you pray for somebody, if you have thoughts, negative thoughts, it could be the devil, it could be your own, it could be your own soul. Whatever it is, don't let it come out your mouth.
Amen.
Do not let those thoughts come out of your mouth. Thoughts cannot keep, the thoughts don't kill your faith.
Amen.
When it comes out of your mouth, that's what kills the faith. That's what kills what you had just commanded to happen. You command life, don't let death come out of your mouth. So 2 days went by, same thing. 2 days went by. I'm like, God, you're faithful. I'm depending on you. This is something that you have to do. I'm incapable of doing it. And 2 days later or 3 days later, got the report, labor stopped. I wasn't there to witness it. That would have been nice if she'd have stopped, the pain had stopped in front of me, but it didn't. It didn't stop in front of me. 2 days later, I got the report. Pain stopped. Child was back to normal. Moving and everything back to normal. Don't take what you see on the face as the reality. The reality is, Jesus said, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you can command a mulberry tree to be uprooted and planted in the sea. That's it. You command it. It has to happen.
Amen. Amen. Okay, very good. Any last minute questions before we wrap up for the evening? I'm seeing one question. Yes, sir. This is going to be a good one, I can tell.
Hi there. Oh, yeah, okay. So, we were at the dinner table after the session this afternoon. And my wife says, I said, well, are you coming to the meeting tonight? I knew she was thinking about it. And she said, yeah, except that I'm not feeling very good. And in fact, maybe I won't. And I said, you've got to be kidding me. We're at a healing conference, and you're not going to come to the meeting tonight because you don't feel well. Well, I've got Andy's cell phone number. Why don't we call him and ask him if he could pray for you tonight? And she says, no, I don't feel comfortable with that. Okay, I'll tell you what. I'll pray for you, and then we'll see what happens. She says, okay. So, we pray across the table with each other, and she says, well, it feels a lot better. And I said, great. But then I looked at her, and her composure was sort of down, like she was feeling still sick. And I said, oh, it didn't work. And she said, oh, it's back again. I said, when did that happen? When you said it didn't work. I said, well, let's pray again. And so we prayed again, and that time I didn't say anything, and she said it went back to where it was. It's better. I said, okay, so can you come because you feel better? He says, yeah, I can come, but now I'm tired. And I figured, well, she was up most of the night. I said, okay, well, that's fine. But that's her story.
Amen. That's very cool. I'm glad I could help you with your question, man. That's a great testimony, isn't it? It shows you that demons pay attention to your words. And that your words do have authority. You don't have to manage everybody else's words. You don't. Because when you stand and speak in your authority, the kingdom of God trumps everything else. All right? I saw one other hand. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. I just have a question. Do you ever talk to people about watching their words afterwards so they don't negate their own feelings?
That's a great question. She said, do you ever talk to people about watching their words so they don't negate their own healing? You know, there's a lot of things that you can do to help people walk in the kingdom, right? And so a lot of it depends, honestly, about what that person needs. And so there's times where I talk to people and I'm really seeking to establish a relationship to say, hey, do you know that this is something that God will do through any Christian, and we, you know, do you have a, you know, would you like to learn more about this or something like that? So, you know, you can do that. Sometimes, if you have a card that you have not just your own contact information. Listen, I don't like do this to try to recruit people. Okay, there's times where it feels like giving them a card would reaffirm. Oh, see, I knew there was a catch. Now you're just out here doing this kind of. But there's times where you feel like, you know, you're offering more of yourself, right? It's a give, it's not a take. And so giving that to them so that they have an opportunity to say, hey, if you ever need to get in touch with me, and then here's some good online resources, right? A couple of websites that I would highly recommend. So that's a great follow-up tool for people, and especially if you have a life team or a local work that you could help people get connected with. That's a great thing too. But, you know, I have to be honest with you, okay? Jesus, don't do this like as a church growth plan. Do this because it's a kingdom growth plan, right? Because Jesus did not see a whole lot of people coming back to him. You know, he healed 10, one of them came back, you know? So you need to understand, sometimes people are just a little bit freaked out by the whole thing, and they get moved forward in the kingdom, but that might have been your part in their life. So yes, I will tell people, I will coach them sometimes, I will give some immediate follow-up, but what follow-up I do, we don't have faith in words. We have faith in Jesus. So usually I'm pointing them toward understanding Jesus, because people always speak out of what fills their hearts. So if they still believe the same belief system and just don't say that, you know, because they're doing their best to watch their words, then eventually it's going to come out their mouth because it still is what fills their hearts. And so I will usually point them more towards helping them have a revelation of Christ that's more complete and full. I've seen his hand about 3 times. And
yep. My question, when you get to the point of, let's say the person is open and you want to lead them to the Lord, I myself don't really believe in a sinner's prayer thing. I don't see any scriptural basis for that.
Yeah.
How do you approach that?
That's a great question. Do you hear the question? He doesn't believe in the sinner's prayer because he doesn't see a scriptural basis for it. And so how do you approach leading someone to Christ? So one of the things that I'll do, I don't believe in the sinner's prayer either in the sense that we've made it into a magic formula. But I do believe in having someone act on their faith. And so one of the things that I will do is say, hey, buddy, do you want to get your life right with God right now? Because Jesus Christ died to be your Savior, and He is Lord of all. So if you're willing to turn and follow Him, He will save you and change your life and come into your life. Do you want to do that? And they'll say, yeah. And they say, well, let's start off just by talking to Jesus. So I'll lead them into what would typically be called a sinner's prayer. But then I'll say, Jesus said that following Him means that you become His disciple. That you're following Him. And that He starts that off with being baptized, that you totally bury your old life like underwater, and that's that symbol that, you know what, I'm going to do this ridiculous thing about getting totally dunked into water to show that my old life is completely buried, and then I'm raised up totally immersed and saturated with God. Amen. And so then I'm taking that step. Would you be interested in learning more about how you can follow Jesus? Because I'd love to meet with you wherever you feel comfortable. And you know, so you offer yourself. You mentioned baptism, and you offer yourself to come get involved with them on their turf. Not just, hey, you need to come to my church meeting, and you know, because there's a whole lot of barriers in churchianity. And I believe that when I read the New Testament, I see two things. They call on the name of the Lord and they're baptized, right? That the baptism, that was that whole self in. It's just not an empty word with no action. It's not just eyes closed and heads bowed. That they start that first act of faith is that Jesus is Lord. And I demonstrate this by doing something ridiculous, right? That I say, I'm gonna. Why else would somebody be baptized? Because somebody else told me to. Amen? And so that's where usually things start. So I will lead them in a sinner's prayer, but I just don't say, hey, now you're saved. You know, that's something that's, you know, I'm saying, look, follow Jesus, because believers in Him are saved. And if you believe, you need to back that up with your actions, and so you minister to them. I'm seeing other hands. Bob, do you have anything you want to say to that?
We're commanded to make disciples, not converts.
Yeah.
So if the door is open to continue the ministry of discipleship, disciple making, that's what you should do.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm going to answer maybe one or two more questions, and then we got to get going. Just respect everybody's time. I saw your hand in the back there. Are you good?
Yeah, I just saw part of the sinner's prayer that includes repentance too, right?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, all right.
Yeah, repentance is simply turning away from your own way. You're following Jesus. So whatever way they were going, I'll guarantee you it wasn't following Jesus. Right? So you don't have to use the word repent for somebody to actually repent.
Sure.
Get it? Okay, yeah.
We spoke a lot about, physical pain.
Yeah.
Tonight. Can you give us an example of, say, praying for somebody that has emotional
pain.
Or pain from the heart, from like from a wound or from, you know, a divorce or from, you know, that kind of pain?
I'll tell you what, that I could, but I'm going to ask Curry that tomorrow, because that kind of gets us into another section that would take a little bit of a biblical explanation. But I'm very comfortable to answer that question. I think it's a question that a lot of people here have, so make sure that it winds up in Curry's basket, because I'm sure his answer is going to be stellar, because he's a great guy. Right now, in the name of Jesus, spirit of fear, go! That's probably not how I did it. All right. So tomorrow, one of the things that that we may do, Kevin, may ask for people, if you've been healed since you've come to the conference, just to stand, and maybe some of you, even if you would be interested, just to share a brief testimony, just by way of encouraging others. So, you know, please seal your seal. Seal the deal. Just give God the glory. Amen. Yeah. So don't be shocked. We didn't do that so that we could get testimonies. This is giving you an opportunity to step on the platform and shine the light on Jesus. The other thing I just want to mention, just for some follow-up materials, my book in the back is it's called Immersed into God, Pouring Out the Life That Jesus Put Into You, Put Inside You. This really goes into in a lot more depth in a lot of different areas about how to get your own self established in your identity in Christ, and then be able to minister out on the streets to pour the life out, not just in healing, but in prophecy and testimony and ministering the baptism of the Holy Spirit to other people, casting out demons, all kinds of stuff. So if you're interested, that's on the back table. It should be there tomorrow as well. It's $20 on that. And then there's another one that we just finished that was written by a team of people. I was a general editor and one of the main contributors to the book. It's called God Heals Birth Defects. There's a worldwide movement right now of people who've been taking this DHT message, and they're laying hands on people that have been born with cerebral palsy, autism, Down syndrome, and 50% of this book is testimonies written firsthand by parents who are seeing God heal their children. I've had a lot of people say that they've read this, not even having someone who's directly involved, that they're directly involved with, that have birth defects, and they've just, I don't know, they've been very encouraging just to hear that. So that's in the back as well, as kind of a follow-up resource.
Just one final practical suggestion when you're praying with others in the public. I worked for several years on the prayer team in the Brownsville Revival, and we literally laid hands on thousands and thousands of people. Imagine this. Something else? Fresh anointing.
Yeah.
Right? You do not, you can destroy your testimony with, something like bad breath. You actually can. Fresh breath. A couple of minutes is all it takes. Make sure you got some fresh breath before you're speaking life over somebody, or they're going to interpret it as death.
So that's... That's what started that whole phenomena of being slain in the spirit.
And that thing tomorrow when we might actually, I don't know if it'll be Friday or Saturday, but if we ask some people to come up and just walk up and say, is anyone healed? You know, you just come up and say, hey, my back pain was healed last night. Or we'll have maybe some other people stand up and say, who saw their first healing that... You know, God healed the first person through them. And the reason we want you to stand up and the reason we want you to say it is because God gave this to everyone.
Amen.
And most people don't step out into this because they think you need to have a special gift. You need to be specially anointed. God need to pick you. You have to know so much. And it's not. It's for every single one of us who made Jesus our Lord. And we have to get that point across to everyone else. So your input and assistance is vital in reaching someone. So don't be shy, because when you step out in this, you can't be shy anyway. But it'll just really help people to know, hey, they just showed me, I did it, it works, let's go.
Amen. Amen. Be blessed. Has this been helpful to anybody?
Yes.
Go Jesus.
This isn't for theologians. This is just really, if Jesus is your Lord, you made him Lord of your life, and he's in you, then all of you in this room can have these testimonies.
Okay. So I just want to say a special thank you to Bob Spurlock and Andy Hayden for leading the groups, leading the teams, and I don't think there was a single team out there that didn't see miracles. All of them did. All of them did. So you're only going to hear a small sample, but here it goes.
Hi, my name is Carmen. I came down from Canada to do the DHT training, and I really wanted to get prepared to go out and on the streets and pray for people I never even knew, which is totally out of my box. I never did that before. But we got the training here through the week, and last night me and my partner, we went out, and my partner approached this lady and asked her if she had any pain or anything in her body. And she said, yes, I've got severe migraine going on. She said, I just called my family member to come and get me, take me to the hospital. And he said, oh, wow. He said, we're got the healing from God. We pray for people and they get healed. Would you mind if we pray for you? She said, no, I'll take that. And so he prayed for her. And after he prayed, he said, do you feel anything better? And she goes, yes, I feel a bit better. And he goes, oh, well, here's my partner. He prays for people too, and they get healed. Do you want to get him to pray for you? And she said, yeah. So I prayed for her, and I rebuked, I cursed the infirmity that she had. I told it to leave in Jesus' name, and I laid hands on her, and I told her body to be healed in Jesus' name. And then my partner, who's used to interviewing, said, how do you feel now? And she said, much better. So praise God. Thank you.
How's it going, guys? My name is Ian Cron. We went out last night and we led a new group of people that hadn't gone and done it before. And so we were kind of showing them how to break the ice and stuff. So I went out with a girl, Jessica, and she was super bold and did a great job. But she would go in and snipe people. So she'd point at somebody and, okay, I have to go break the ice, right? And so she kind of got a little bit mean with me, and I couldn't really see the person. She's like, oh, around the corner, guy in a tank top, green shirt. I'm like, oh, yeah, no problem. So I step around the corner, and it's just this huge guy, just ripped and tattoos and stuff. I'm like, oh boy, here we go. Yeah, no problem. I'm like, hey man, how's it going? And kind of told him what we were doing, and you know, he seemed super intimidating and tough, but he was just like, really, he's like, oh man, that's so cool. No, I feel great. I'm like, oh, okay. But he goes, but my son's around the corner, and he just rolled his ankle super bad, and he's limping and stuff, so you can pray for him. I'm like, oh, awesome. So we go around the corner, and we go to his son, and he's a little bit standoffish, and like, what are these weird people coming around to do, right? So we were just really cool with him, and laid hands on his ankle and commanded healing in Jesus' name, and instantly he was, his ankle was 100%, all the pain was gone. And so I just wanted to share that as an encouragement. You know, a lot of times people seem like really tough and intimidating, and oh, no, don't talk to that person. But, you know, 9 times out of 10, these people are super receptive and super open to it, and they really appreciate it, right? So.
Hi, guys. My name is Leah, and last night was about the second time I've gone out and prayed for people, and when approached this one lady that I just asked her if she had any pain in her body, and she told me that her knee was bugging her, and so I commanded all the pain to leave in Jesus' name. And she had, I asked her before, like, if it was like what the pain was on a scale of 0 to 10, and she told me that it was at an 8. And so after she started walking around, and I said, how did that feel? And she said, it's at a 0, and I can walk. And so, yeah. It's
hi, I'm Daniel. I'm from Canada, Edmonton area. And, yay! last night, I went out. This isn't my first time experiencing miracles, but I received the training and the teaching this week, and we went out, and one of my team members, actually a girl I just saw, Leah, she saw this guy in a wheelchair, and so that's what caught our eye, and so we went over to him, and you know, we struck up a conversation with him, and you know, asked if we could pray for him, and he said yes, and we prayed for him. You know, and we didn't see anything happen right then and there. And I was like, oh, okay, well, my faith stays with you, that Jesus is going to heal you. And the caretaker who was with him, her name was Natisha, and she's just this beautiful lady. And and we were talking to her, and I like spotted this brace on her arm, and I was like, oh, can I pray for that too? And she's like, sure. So I prayed, and nothing happened. And then my friend Jimmy, he's like, you want to take that off? And she's like, sure. So she takes it off, and I said, you know, just prayed again in the name of Jesus that the pain would come out and leave her body and not return. And so I was like, give it a try. So she tries it out. She's like, oh, most of the pain's gone. And then she's like, I'm like, well, let's pray again. And so we pray again. I was like, pain come out right now in the name of Jesus and do not return. And all the pain left her hand. You just see this big smile come to her. And she's just affected with the healing of God. And the thing that I've really been learning this week that Curry's been teaching is just that we can expect now from God, because God has already done it, and it's just us lining up with Him. So that's my story.
Hi, I'm Alyssa, and the other day, yesterday, we were out at Kmart, and we came across a woman in a scooter, and her legs weren't as strong as they should be, and they were a little bit weaker. So we said, okay, can we pray for you? And we struck up a conversation and we prayed. And so then after that, we got her up. She started walking. We walked down the aisle. We walked, we turned back. And then I asked her, we were about almost done coming back to everyone. And you know, we were talking. And she said, yeah, my legs, they should have been weak by now, but they're not. So she sat back down in the scooter. And she said, I'm going to go take this back. And so then she took it back. And later we saw her again. And she was as normal as could be. She had a regular shopping cart just walking.
Hi, I'm Trevor. And I actually saw a healing for myself. I had claw feet, and I actually checked it out this morning, and I actually got healed of it. And I also I actually had a problem with my hips, and it's completely healed. And also God did a really great healing in my foot. I had a cast on for about 4 months, and it's completely healed. And so I actually was at a place that's at McDonald's, and there was me and a couple of other people actually, you know, went there with me, and so we just encountered a lady that got healed from her back. She had arthritis in her spine, and she's completely healed. And then we also prayed for her head, and she had a couple staples in her head, and we were just like commanding her head that the staples would actually leave. And she also had a headache, and it's completely gone. That's it. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Josiah. I'm from Canada. So today at lunch, we were heading out for lunch, and we were praying for a guy in the lobby, and this guy David was watching us, and he approached us in the parking lot, and he's like, hey guys, like I got this thing in my stomach, and you know, doctors say it's incurable, I don't know what to do, I just gotta live with it, and so we were just like, yeah, we're on, so we prayed for him, and it was just like, bop, and he's like, okay, I don't feel anything, so he goes and I guess drinking water, and it affects it or something, so he grabs a bottle of water, and he's just like, it doesn't hurt, you know? We were just like pumped, right? And I'm like, yeah, it's awesome. And I just slapped him in his stomach. And he's like, that would hurt so bad. It didn't hurt, so I'm just like, this is awesome. And then we go for lunch, get back, and he comes afterwards, and he's like, guys, I have this spicy food in my lunch, it doesn't hurt. And he's just like, he's done. It's awesome. So that's
really hey guys, how are you? So I'm from Canada.
I was sitting in my igloo, and I just decided to make the trek to Brittany. I'm kidding, we have houses too. But yeah, we were we went out last night and took some people who hadn't really seen much on the streets, just a lot of people who prayed for them. We went to a park and we showed up and there was a man, he was sitting in a chair, he was like catching some rays right there. And so we see Dennis and his wife. Dennis is sitting in his chair and he's catching some rays, like connecting to John Cash, who's just awesome. And so he's sitting there and we get talking. My friend, who had never seen him before, he starts talking to his back. Finds out his back, he's had problems for years. And he's never really been able to straighten out. So we're like, okay, man, well, why don't you stand up? We'll just pray for you. We're gonna take care of this for you. And so, you know, we're gonna like, he's getting up and he's obviously like feeling it, right? And so we're like, okay, well, maybe we should help. And he's like, nope. You know, he stands up. And it took a little bit of time, right? It was his thing. And so he stands up and we start praying for him. Nothing happens at first, we pray again. You know, we speak to the mountain. The mountain moves, right? In the name of Jesus. And so all of a sudden, he went down a bit. And so he went back and he sat down in his chair. You could tell it was still hurting. And I was just like, man, like, sometimes it's like a knob that just like turns down. You know? And so we prayed for him, and he's sitting in his chair, and we start talking, and all of a sudden he's like, oh my gosh, the pain is gone. It's gone. He's like, I still feel it in my neck though. And so he's like, come right. This is my friend Tyler, who's never seen a healing before. He puts his hand in this guy's neck, he commands that pain to leave, and 100% of the pain leaves his body. So, yeah, right?
And a brother of mine named Drew, and he's never done this stuff before. He just went up to me, he's like, what are you, where do you hurt? And I'm like, oh, my back's always trouble in my life. I broke it a couple times. And he laid hands on me, and the pain just went right away, and they're both pretty shocked, so praise the Lord.
My name is Courtney, and I'm just going to start off by saying that I have gone out before with people, but I have never personally laid my hands on someone and prayed. So we're at the mall last night, and we come onto these two young men, and we're talking to them and just saying, you know, do you have any pain? Like, how are you guys doing? And one guy's, oh, I'm fine, and the other guy's, well, my knee. He tore his ACL and he had surgery, but he still experienced like a clicking whenever he bent it. So I just put my hand on his knee and I said, pain be gone in Jesus' name right now. And the look on his face was just like so amazing. He was in shock because he couldn't feel anything. He's testing it out and jumping around. He's like, this is awesome because I'm just about to go to the gym and play basketball and I can finally like really give it now. So that was really neat.
My name's Nate and I'm from Montana. And last night was the first time I went out with a group and we actually stopped someone on the street. And this young lady had her hand in a rack. And she said she had fallen and sprained it very bad. And so we just asked to pray for her. And she put out her hand and I just held it and said, in the name of Jesus, pain go now. And instantly you could see this blank look on her face and you knew something had changed. And she was like hiding behind the guy she was with and she eventually took her wrap off and she's like trying it out, couldn't find the pain anymore. And so, as much as that was a miracle in and of itself, the greatest joy was being able to share Christ with her and the guy with her immediately after that.
Hello, my name is Mike from Indiana. This is my wife, Ginevra. We went to the mall yesterday with Andy, this guy who had been in the war in Afghanistan and Somalia. He had a shoulder injury on his left shoulder. He had surgery on it. Wasn't healed properly. Didn't have full motion in his shoulder. So I laid hands on his shoulder and commanded his shoulder to be healed in Jesus' name. And before I could tell him, I think I did tell him to move it. He started moving it, and he was completely healed right there. Then Andy prayed for him. He got delivered from PTSD, and he got saved right after that.
My name is Darren. I'm from Washington State, and I went out with Bob and a couple other individuals last night to Walmart, and we were walking around and saw this one gal that had a knee brace on, and I thought one of the other people with us was going to pray for her, and they had talked to her, and so I'm coming around the corner, and I hear, and Darren lays his hands on people and they get healed instantly. And I had never done this. It's like, okay, I'm on the spot, right? And all I did was, she had this knee brace on. I pointed to her knee and I said, be healed in Jesus' name. And I asked her, what are you not supposed to do with your knee, or what can't you do? She said, well, I can't put any weight on it or jump around on it. I can bend it a little bit. I said, well, why don't you try it out? So she picked it up and started bending it a little bit. And then she put all of her weight on it and started hopping up and down on it. But it was fine. So, amazing miracle to me as well. So.
Hi, everybody. My name is Henry. And I'm here with my wife and my baby. And yesterday, it was actually at lunchtime, we went to our hotel to put the little one to sleep. And it got kind of late because he took his time to fall asleep. So I just grabbed my book and I started heading back. And as I go out my room, I pass these two room service people. And I just walked by them and I heard in my heart, go back, talk to them. And I was like, oh, no, I gotta go, I'm late. And then it was strong, it was go back, talk to them. And I was like, all right. And I just went back and I looked at them too and I said, guys, I got a crazy question for you. And they both looked at me kind of weird. I was like, do you have anything that's really bothering you in your body right now? And she looked at me and she said something I'm not going to repeat. Turned around, walked away, and then I looked at him and he's like, yeah, actually my finger really hurts, I can't move it. I was like, no way, since when? And he said, well, ever since I broke it. I was like, no way, can I see it? And I looked at him kind of like this, and the fact is I never prayed for anything like that. He's like, yeah, sure, just put his finger in my hand. And it took like 10 seconds. I just said, in the name of Jesus, pain you go, finger you're going to work now. And I just kind of dropped it, and he started moving, and he's like, oh, it's working. And I was like, man, you know what just happened? He's like, nope. I said, I was going to pass you, but Jesus loves you so much that he brought me back to heal you and to show you how much he loves you. And he's like, I needed that so much. And so, yeah, praise God.